As President Biden considers who he will choose to succeed Justice Stephen Breyer on the Supreme Court, we take a deep dive into some of the potential nominees reportedly on the short list. What looks like a bipartisan stamp of approval makes a South Carolina federal judge one of the top contenders. Lisa Desjardins starts our series by answering the question, who is J. Michelle Childs?
On top of her lists of firsts and standout accomplishments, South Carolina's Michelle Childs uniquely has this displayed at her 2010 federal bench confirmation hearing. Open, bipartisan support.
Judge Childs has demonstrated a dedication to the job and a work ethic unmatched by other judges.
And she will do a great job for the people of South Carolina.
A nod Republican Senator Lindsey Graham pointedly repeated last month.
She's one of the most decent people I've ever met.
Born in Detroit, Childs moved to South Carolina after the death of her father, who was a police officer. She excelled in high school, a lengthy yearbook entry reflecting all her accolades, the National Honor Society, even 3 years of perfect attendance.
She's just been a person who has a work ethic and a drive that's unmatched.
Attorney and former city councilman Luther Battiste has known Childs since she was a student. When she won full scholarships to the University of South Florida for undergrad and then the University of South Carolina Law School.
She's different from many candidates who traditionally have an Ivy League background.
From there, Childs joined a private law firm.
She's unflappable. You can't get her worked up.
Leighton Lord worked with Childs at the Nexon Pruitt Law Firm in Columbia, South Carolina, where she was promoted to partner.
I didn't grow up in the South. But I thought it was a pretty big deal. She just made partner like everybody else.
In this 2020 virtual forum, Childs said she didn't realize what she'd done.
At the time I became partner, I did not know that I was the first Black female in the state of South Carolina that had made partner in a major law firm.
Then something else unusual. Childs left the firm to take high-ranking jobs at the State Department of Labor and then the Workers' Compensation Commission. In 2006, she became a state judge, which requires election by the state legislature.
For the average person, that was an arduous, distasteful process. For Judge Childs, it was the easiest thing in the world. She is such a people person.
Childs handled some high-profile cases, including a 2007 armored car heist. She made headlines for sentencing some of the young men involved to 25 years in prison. In 2010, she and a family of support came to Washington.
I'd like to acknowledge my family.
And the Senate unanimously confirmed her as a federal judge.
Is there objection? Without objection, so ordered.
From her bench came a few big decisions. In 2014, she ruled in favor of two women seeking to have their marriage recognized, declaring South Carolina's refusal a violation of constitutional rights. That was the year before the Supreme Court upheld same-sex marriages. And amid the 2020 election and the coronavirus, Childs ruled in favor of easier voter access to absentee ballots and against a Republican witness requirement. Childs says what she wants is to be fair.
I want people to feel like when they come before me, that they don't feel like they've been prejudged. Of course, I want to be well prepared, but I want them to feel that they have the opportunity to present their advocacy to me.
For her, the law's living, and it's something that is going to affect people's rights, going to affect their lives.
Judea Davis clerked for Childs from 2018 to 2019. We talked to her about some doubts on the left, including this story from the American Prospect, charging that Childs is too punitive in sentencing, or this from the Young Turks, who fear she's too close to large businesses.
She has a history of representing employers over the best interests of employees.
Judea Davis says those concerns are unfounded.
She didn't ever weigh one side more than the other. It was, here are the impacts of this person's decisions, the impacts both on them and their family, and the impacts on the victim and their family, and the impacts on the community generally.
Davis is thinking of the Supreme Court and her mentor.
On a more personal level, she's a Black female, she's a mother, all of which inspires me. There's obviously a lot of debate about how women can perform in the workforce, that they can do it at a high level. I think she's done that while raising a family and being a wife, being a mother. And so those two aspects are super inspiring to me.
Childs also likes to engage on diversity, as she did with humor when giving feedback during a Duke Law School competition.
One little critique about you. One time I asked you a question and you said, yes, sir. I just want you to know there are some women on the bench.
That is the final pitch for supporters of Michelle Childs, that she would reshape the bench the most. South Carolina Congressman Jim Clyburn.
I just think that it is time for us to diversify the court, not just as relates to gender, but as it relates to color as well, and as it relates to backgrounds and experiences.
In any case, Judge Childs should be ready for a promotion. She was nominated to the Court of Appeals last year. Confirmation is expected if she isn't nominated to the Supreme Court instead.
And Lisa Desjardins joins us now. So, Lisa, you have done some more reporting today on Judge Childs' work history. What did you learn?
You know, Judge Childs is unique in this aspect that she is receiving open criticism from some on the left. Some progressives, as we reported, questioning her time working as a private attorney for business clients, and also when she was the deputy director of the state's Labor Department. I spoke today to the woman who headed the Labor Department at the time, Rita McKinney, and she told me that in her experience over 2 years with Childs, that Childs was relentlessly open-minded to every case she heard, and in fact that workplace situations improved under Childs from the areas that she managed during that time. We did our research, and in fact, it is true that in the 2 years that Childs was in that job, that the number of workplace injuries and diseases reported did go down for workers in South Carolina. And in fact, also Childs did do some kind of groundbreaking work reaching out to migrant workers with a task force for non-English speakers and offering housing, those kinds of things. Again, those who support her say she is open-minded. She sees both sides. The question here is, what is balance? Progressives say they want someone who leans more clearly left. Judge Childs is an example of someone who has clearly ruled on each case on its own, say her supporters.
President Biden plans to personally interview potential nominees to the Supreme Court this week, and likely among them will be federal judge Ketanji Brown Jackson. Jackson isn't new to Supreme Court consideration. She was seen as a long shot pick back in 2016 when former President Obama was looking to fill a vacancy. This go round, she is seen as a leading contender. Geoff Bennett has this report on how she got here.
And that I'm even-handedly applying the law in every case.
Ketanji Brown Jackson has a resume seemingly tailor-fit for the moment. Harvard grad, Supreme Court clerk, and a federal judge with a deep history in public service.
There is a direct line from my defender service to what I do on the bench.
D.C.-born and Miami-raised, Jackson stood out early, excelling in high school as class president and on the debate team. Even then, her goal was clear. She's quoted in her senior yearbook saying, "I want to go into law and eventually have a judicial appointment." Her teenage years were key to achieving that, as she put it in 2017.
It was my high school experience as a competitive speaker that taught me how to lean in despite the obstacles.
With honors degrees from Harvard and Harvard Law, Jackson scored three federal clerkships, including one under the justice she may now replace.
Justice Breyer plucked me from obscurity and gave me the opportunity of a lifetime.
And I will say she is adored among the Breyer clerk family.
She made a lasting impression, said fellow Breyer clerk and former acting U.S. Solicitor General Neil Katyal.
She's fearless, and also she's a real person. And sometimes that's not always true with Supreme Court justices who live in an elite, rarefied atmosphere. But she's a judge who's never forgotten the human side of judging.
She's seen that human side up close, with family on both sides of the justice system. Her brother working for the Baltimore Police Department, and her uncle serving a life sentence for a cocaine conviction.
Justice demands this result.
She worked to understand and improve the system as a public defender and as vice chair of the U.S. Sentencing Commission.
That is an unusual addition and I think a valuable perspective.
Margaret Russell is a constitutional law professor who says Jackson's criminal defense background sets her apart.
There are many former prosecutors who are already on the bench. But what's interesting about a public defender, and really quite rare on the court, it's been a couple of decades, is that focus on the indigent defendant, someone who is really lacking an opportunity, often despised, often overlooked.
On the Sentencing Commission, Jackson continued that work, fighting for more equitable drug penalties.
There is no federal sentencing provision that is more closely identified with unwarranted disparity and perceived systemic unfairness than the 100-to-1 crack powder penalty distinction.
That was the first of three Senate confirmations for Jackson. In 2012, she was nominated to the federal bench in Washington, D.C., introduced by then-Congressman Paul Ryan, who's related to Jackson by marriage.
But my praise for Ketanji's intellect, for her character, for her integrity, it's unequivocal. She's an amazing person.
She earned a reputation on the district court for being thorough and methodical.
You can tell she has that speech and debate background because she likes to engage with the parties.
Sanchi Kare and Neha Sabharwal clerked for Jackson and say they were struck by her work ethic.
One thing that she would tell us when I was clerking for her is that, you know, you can't always expect to be the smartest person in the room, but you can promise to be the hardest working. And she truly lives by that philosophy.
And by the warm welcome she extended.
And she came out of her office, huge smile, gave me a huge hug, and told me how excited she was that I would be working for her. And that sort of set the tone for the rest of my clerkship experience.
A memory that I still have of her is this relay race in which several DC Circuit and DDC chambers participated. And at the judge's suggestion, we made matching t-shirts and set up a training schedule and lined up everyone in chambers to participate because she just has so much spirit for everything that she does and her diligence is really contagious.
It was there on the district court that Jackson sentenced more than 100 people and penned some of her best known opinions. In 2017, she presided over the so-called Pizzagate conspiracy case, delivering a 4-year prison sentence for a man who fired his gun in a DC pizza shop, wrongly believing it was home to a child sex ring. And in 2019, she ordered that former Trump White House counsel Don McGahn comply with a congressional subpoena during the Russia investigation. Citing against the Trump administration, she plainly wrote, "Presidents are not kings."
One thing is clear. The 120-page ruling had a purpose.
It came up at her third Senate appearance, this one for the D.C. Court of Appeals, seen as a tryout for a Supreme Court hearing.
I am both humbled and very grateful to be here once again.
Republicans took aim at Jackson's public defender clients.
Have you ever represented a terrorist at Guantanamo Bay?
About 16 years ago when I was a federal public defender.
And her identity.
What role does race play, Judge Jackson, in the kind of judge that you have been and the kind of judge you will be?
I don't think that race plays a role in the kind of judge that I have been and that I would be.
Behind her at those hearings, her husband, Dr. Patrick Jackson, and one of their two daughters. The pair met in college and were, as she says, an unlikely match at first.
He and his twin brother are, in fact, sixth generation Harvard. By contrast, I am only the second generation in my family to go to any college, and I'm fairly certain that if you traced my family back past my grandparents, who were raised in Georgia, by the way, you would find that my ancestors were slaves on both sides.
The yeas are 53, the nays are 44. The nomination is confirmed.
She was ultimately confirmed with 53 votes, all 50 Democrats plus Republican senators Susan Collins, Lisa Murkowski, and Lindsey Graham. That put Jackson, now 51 years old, in the seat formerly held by another Supreme Court hopeful.
Today I am nominating Chief Judge Merrick Brian Garland to join the Supreme Court.
Before then-President Obama made that decision in 2016, Jackson's 11-year-old daughter wrote in with her own suggestion.
Dear Mr. President, while you are considering judges to fill Justice Scalia's seat on the Supreme Court, I would like to add my mother, Ketanji Brown Jackson, of the District Court, to the list.
6 years later, it seems President Biden might be listening.
We continue our series of profiles of the women we believe are on his short list. Tonight, California Supreme Court Justice Leondra Kruger, who, unlike some of the other top contenders, has never faced questions from the Senate Judiciary Committee. Geoff Bennett has our report.
It's a title Leondra Kruger already knows well, justice. While she'd be the first Black woman to join the court, being the first is a position she knows well, too. Kruger grew up in the suburbs of Los Angeles, both parents doctors. Her mother immigrated from Jamaica, her father the son of European Jewish immigrants. She attended an elite prep school where she played the cello and was editor of the school paper. That led to undergrad at Harvard and then Yale Law School, where she became the first Black woman to serve as editor-in-chief of the Yale Law Journal.
At the time, I didn't even understand what a trailblazing selection she was.
Renato Mariotti is a former federal prosecutor who attended law school with Kruger.
I cannot imagine herding a more difficult set of cats than herding the editors in the Yale Law Journal. It really speaks well to her ability to work well with others and build a consensus.
Even as she was breaking barriers, Mariotti says the effects of racism were still very clear.
There's a cab that passed her up, even though she was in a business suit hailing a cab right in front of me, and came and stopped by me instead. And I remember I opened the door for her to get in and get into my cab that I had hailed. And she gave me this look that I didn't understand at the time. I can imagine that it's just part of what she's had to go through her entire life.
Kruger's first job at the Supreme Court was as a clerk for the late John Paul Stevens, the long-serving liberal justice. She later recalled the advice he gave his former clerks on his 99th birthday.
Always work hard and do your best.
Years later, she entered the courtroom again, this time as an advocate representing the U.S. government in the Solicitor General's office for both Republican and Democratic presidents.
Mr. Chief Justice, and may it please the court.
She argued 12 cases before the justices, more than any other Black woman in history.
She is so smart, so careful, so meticulous, so poised.
Neil Katyal named Kruger his deputy when he served as acting U.S. Solicitor General in the Obama administration. He sat in the chambers during 10 of Kruger's cases.
I was blown away by her ability to take withering criticism, pause, smile, and answer it head on. She clearly had the respect of every justice on the Supreme Court.
That poise under pressure was seen in one of the most high-profile cases she argued for the government. At issue, religion and employment discrimination. The position, she argued, has become a potential red flag for conservatives who fear she could be hostile to religious liberty. Both conservative and liberal justices sounded skeptical during those arguments.
We think how the inquiry plays out in particular cases may be...
It's extraordinary.
I, too, find that amazing.
And a unanimous court decided against the Obama administration. After leaving the Department of Justice, she moved back to California, appointed to the state Supreme Court by Democratic Governor Jerry Brown. Her confirmation hearing lasted just 35 minutes, and she was unanimously confirmed by the committee, which included then-Attorney General Kamala Harris.
I, Leondra Kruger, do solemnly swear.
When she took the bench in January 2015, she was just 38 years old, one of the youngest justices in state history, and just the second Black woman.
It is a responsibility to approach each case with an open mind and with an awareness that the court's decisions matter in ways that are manifold to the lives of the people that we serve.
All rise.
On the bench, she's seen as a moderating voice.
She often writes unanimous opinions, so it doesn't mean that she's always in disagreement. But her reputation, in addition to being brilliant and well-accomplished, is of being more at the center.
An analysis from the California Constitution Center at UC Berkeley School of Law says she's been the median justice on the court and proceeds from a neutral approach that produces equivalent proportions of relatively liberal and conservative results. She's authored opinions on issues including access to police body camera footage, police searches of vehicles at traffic stops, and the death penalty.
She's immensely talented and is the right pick for this position.
California Chief Justice Tani Cantil-Sekue, herself appointed by former Republican Governor Arnold Schwarzenegger, says Kruger is respected by her colleagues on the bench and works to find common ground.
She's a consensus builder, and she does it with an open mind and fairness, and she does it respectfully. Even though there might come a time in the case where you may depart from her reasoning or she from yours, it's never unreasonable. It's never outlandish. It's always understandable.
An approach, she says, would benefit the U.S. Supreme Court.
Good luck with that. That's not going to happen. I think that this court is very strongly divided. And the best of consensus building personalities will not be able to get over some chasms in interpretations of the Constitution. The divide is clearly there.
One potential hurdle for a nomination, the rise from state court directly to the Supreme Court, is rare.
I do so swear.
It hasn't happened since Sandra Day O'Connor in 1981.
The U.S. Supreme Court, like the California Supreme Court in matters of state law, is a court of last resort.
But for Kruger, it's exactly that experience in California that helps shape how she sees the role of the U.S. Supreme Court.
The United States Supreme Court's job is to help provide answers and advance the understanding and development of the law.
As the president considers who to appoint, this is the second time Kruger has found herself on Biden's radar. She was previously offered the job of Solicitor General, but turned it down.
She thinks of herself more as a judge and less as an advocate.
If she finds herself at the top of Biden's list again, a lifetime appointment and a place in history might be harder to turn down.
What's the significance, as you see it, of Justice Kruger being the first Black woman to sit on the Supreme Court?
We in the judiciary, more than any other branch of government, we rely on the public's trust and confidence. And in order to have that, we, I think, must reflect the diversity of the people whose lives we are intruding upon. It makes it important that people know that we know what's happening to them, we can understand. And so it's a first that will build dreams. It's the kind of first that will be self-affirming, like, yes!
At 45 years old, she'd be the youngest nominee in more than 30 years and be in a position to influence the direction of the Supreme Court for decades to come.